summer, but I'm really glad to see so many here. I thought the weather would keep some of you away. You showed up to protect in the joy Christmas season this morning. I want to give a big, big thank you to Maury. You noticed our tree is lit. Maury spent many hours in that day with wiring tools and fuses and had to completely re-go through the whole tree to get that lit. So that tree is lit because of Maury's service. Went out and caroled all of our shut-ins last night. We got to see every one of them and sang a few carols. Not all of them were in June. We did the best we could. And you could see the smiles on their faces, which just made it truly worth it. So I just want to welcome you here this morning, and I'm going to let Cindy come up with some announcements for today.
On December 24th, from 6 to 7, is Open Communion here at the church. At 7 p.m. is candlelight service. Are there any other announcements before Mike comes over to tell us about the program this evening?
Just remember that the Christmas gifts for the children need to be here by next Sunday. So they need to deliver them on Monday, Tuesday.
Where are they?
They're all the angels have been taken. So maybe next year.
Okay.
All the angels have been taken. So just make sure you bring your gifts back by next Sunday.
Now, in the foyer, we were cleaning out one of the rooms, and there's a whole bunch of Christmas wrapping paper out in the foyer, and we'd like anybody that needs it, wants it, take it.
Okay, if you didn't hear, down in the foyer, there is a lot of Christmas wrapping paper that they found and cleaning out, and you're welcome to take it. Anything else? Mike?
Want to invite you all to come tonight to our Christmas program as Stories from the First Christmas. It's going to be a lot of fun, I hope. A little bit of music. We're going to have some video interviews with some of the people that participated in the first Christmas. It's going to be kind of interesting. So come on and hear the stories as told by those that were there. And if you can, bring some cookies. We'll meet down in Sherwood Hall afterwards. We'll have some cookies and some punch just fellowship together afterwards. It'll be a good evening. That's at 7 o'clock tonight.
Let us now greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ.
Hi, Mary.
It's kind of a dreary day.
Are you this
morning? Oh, it is. It's that hard.
We're in the
morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And good morning to you.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
Good.
How are you doing?
Not too bad.
We opted out since in Dog City, so we.
Yeah.
And they won, of course, since we didn't go.
Yeah. Maybe that is. Maybe we can stay away from it.
Even Jesus said, "It is not those who are healthy who need a physician, but those who are sick." Matthew 9:12. The Bible goes on to tell us in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, "Consider your calling, brethren, that there are not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong. And the base things of the world and the despised, God has chosen the things that are not, that he might nullify the things that are, that no man should boast before God." And so we come today to light the third candle of the Advent wreath, that we may remember the shepherds. We will have the light of the Advent at this time.
our time of preparation for the birthday of our son. May the lighting of this candle remind us that we need a Savior. We realize that all of us have fallen short of your glory and we are sinful. As we view this candle, may we also remember that your word is faithful and that your promises will burn brightly in our lives. Amen.
Thank you, ladies. This morning, as we move further into our worship this morning, we're talking about joy today. But you know what is joy? A lot of people equate joy with happiness, but there are two different things. Happiness is having things we want. We want, did you hear that? But joy is having what we need. Joy is having what we need spiritually. By pursuing our worldly wants, we might be able to make ourselves happy for a time, but we won't be fulfilling our spiritual needs. But by following God, we will fulfill those spiritual needs. We can experience true joy through God. From another perspective, you know, when someone's unhappy, it's usually because they don't have what they want or what they think they want. So when we can stop wanting worldly goods, we will no longer have a reason to be unhappy. Let us stop wanting those goods. Let us concentrate on God's joy, the gift that comes from Him. And we can be filled with joy all the time. Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now let's turn to our first hymn this morning, Joy to the World.
Received from the Lord's hand double for all of her sins. The voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, we're going to continue on with our celebration of Christmas with the singing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Good will to men.
still sing, by the way. They sing all the time. It's really great. But I was thinking about this week that the angels appeared to the shepherds, and the shepherds were drawn to the manger. And the wise men, looking out in the sky, saw this new star, and they were drawn to the manger. When Jesus was born, he was drawing people to him then. He sent his Holy Spirit to draw us to him now. Draw me close to you.
Silent prayers to begin. many difficult situations, troubled times, and hurting hearts. We lift up those that are going through grievous times and entrust them into your care. We pray that you would sustain them with your sufficient strength and pour into their hearts the joy that comes from you. Thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength, and that you have promised that your grace is sufficient for all eventualities. Keep us all with our hearts fixed on you, and instill in them a joyful disposition that we may bring comfort and cheer to those around us, to be a light to those that are facing troubles and difficulties. And at this time, we ask this in your Son Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
He always rolls his eyes when I tell him that we have to watch Christmas shows because we've seen them over and over and over again. But I'm kind of like Peter Pan. I never grow up. I've got to watch them, so it's just not Christmas. Well, one of my favorites, I like Charlie Brown. Love it when Linus is standing there as the shepherd and he gives his recitation, and that always means a lot. But one of the shows you don't always think about being really a Christmassy Christian show is How the Grinch Stole Christmas. At first glance, it's kind of a children's story, and you're thinking, that's not very nice. You know, why would you want to bring that up? But I think the Grinch teaches us there's a lot more into it than what we first think. A lot of times we can kind of feel like the Grinch does and not be very loving this time of the year. We kind of get taken in by all the things that go on in this time of the year. Or for those who haven't heard it this year, I'll kind of recap briefly the Grinch scene. We all know he's the guy that lives up on top of the mountain trumpet, and he gets so upset every year over hearing all the noise and the commotion and all the extra things that the who's down in Whoville do that just irritate him. And so one year he devises his plan, he's going to steal Christmas. We all know how he dressed up Santa. Goes down the hill, waits till they're asleep, and takes everything they have. Takes every last crumb of food, every decoration, everything that he thinks that they hold meaningful, he takes it. He gets back up to the top of the hill, ready to push it off the top of the cliff, and he stops. Because instead of hearing crying and sobbing and moaning, he hears joy, he hears singing, he hears rejoicing, and he just can't understand how can anybody who has nothing left rejoice. And then it finally comes to him. It comes without ribbons, it comes without tags, it comes without packages, boxes, or bags. Because perhaps Christmas doesn't come from a store, perhaps Christmas means just a little bit more. And that's when his heart grows. And I always like that part because I think, hey, there's still hope for me too. My heart can grow. And we
sometimes get caught up in the grinchiness of the season. All the lines that we wait in, the traffic we have to drive through, try to find a parking place at Walmart, not easy. We cook, we clean, we wear ourselves out trying to maintain the holiday season. But that's not where our joy really comes from. Sometimes we confuse our happiness with our joy. And there's a lot of things that we do during the season that make us happy. We rely on our family and our friends and our gifts and our traditions. And those all bring us happiness, and that's great. There's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes we forget that what is truly important is our Christmas joy. And that comes to us as a gift that was plainly wrapped in a humble manger, given to us by God. We forget that Christmas joy is the fact that it's God's gift to us. Christmas isn't found in all the wrappings or the trappings of the season, not even the good things it has to offer. It comes from knowing that God gave us a perfect gift, plainly wrapped in a humble stable. Our joy comes from knowing that Jesus was born to us so that he could die for us. Joy comes from knowing that regardless of what we're going through, we have a God who walks through it with us. Our joy comes from the hope that one day all our struggles and hurts and heartaches will be taken away forever as we live for eternity in the presence of our God. Luke 2:10 says, I bring you good news of great joy for all that will be for all people. It's not just for some of us, it's for all of us. And Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. So never let the Grinch steal the joy from your heart. Never let him take your happiness. Just remember to rejoice. So in case you have trouble remembering, I've got Grinch pills here. So if you get the feeling grinchy, this will help you take away the Grinch of the season. Savior, Jesus Christ, and keep the true joy in our hearts. May we always rejoice in your love. Amen. Thank you.
Our second scripture today is taken from Mark 1, verse 1 through 10. Hear the word of the Lord. In the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message: after me comes the one more powerful than I am, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. This is the word of God for the people of God. Make sure this song. I'm going to be a little something different today. We've heard about Charlie Brown. We've heard about the Grinch. Well, I'm going to take you to a baseball game. Yay. Baseball game back in 1888. Wow. Listen to this. The outlook wasn't brilliant for the Mudville Nine that day. The score stood 4-2 with about one inning more to play. And then when Cooney died at first and Barrows did the same, a pall-like silence fell on the patrons of the game. A straggling few got up to go in deep despair. The rest clung to that hope which springs eternal in the human breast. They thought, if only Casey could get a whack at that, we'd put up even money now with Casey at the bat. But Flynn preceded Casey, and then also Jimmy Blake, and the former was a hoodoo, while the latter was a cake. So upon that stricken multitude, grim, melancholy set, for there seemed but little chance of Casey getting to the bat. But Flynn let drive a single to the wonderment of all, and Blake, the much despised, tore the cover off the ball. And when the dust had lifted and the men saw what had occurred, there was Jimmy safe at second and Flynn a hugging third. Then from 5,000 throats and more, there rose a lusty yell. It rumbled through the valley, it rattled in the dell, it pounded on the mountain and recoiled on the flat. For Casey, mighty Casey, was advancing to the bat. There was ease in Casey's manner as he stepped into his place. There was pride in Casey's bearing, and a smile lit Casey's face. And when, responding to the cheers, he lightly doffed his hat, not a stranger in the crowd could doubt 'twas Casey at the bat. 10,000 eyes were on him as he rubbed his hands with dirt. 5,000 tongues applauded when he wiped them on his shirt. Then, while the writhing pitcher ground the ball into his hip, defiance flashed in Casey's eye. A sneer curled Casey's lip. And now the leather-covered spear came hurtling through the air, and Casey stood a-watching in haughty grandeur there. Close by the sturdy batsman, the ball unheeded sped. "That ain't my style," said Casey. "Strike one," the umpire said. From the benches, Blackwood people, there went up a muffled roar, like the beating of the storm waves on a stern and distant shore. "Kill him! Kill the umpire!" shouted someone on the stand. And it's likely they'd have killed him had not Casey raised his hand. With a smile of Christian charity, Grant Casey's visage shone. He stilled the rising tumult, he bade the game go on. He signaled to the pitcher, and once more the diamond spear flew. But Casey still ignored it, and the umpire said, "Strike two." "Fraud," called the maddened thousands, and an echo answered fraud. But one scornful look from Casey and the audience was awed. They saw his face grow stern and cold. They saw his muscles strain. And they knew that Casey wouldn't let at all the riot begin. The sneer is gone from Casey's lip. His teeth are clenched in hate. He pounds with cruel whiteness his bat upon the belly. And now the pitcher holds the ball, and now he lets it go. And now the air is shattered by the force of Casey's blow. Oh, somewhere in this favored land, the sun is shining bright. The band is playing somewhere, and somewhere hearts are light. And somewhere men are laughing, and somewhere children shout. But there is no joy in Medville. Mighty Casey has struck out. Now, we wonder, although I know all of you have surmised by now, this is too often what we do. We think our joy is wrapped up in what we do. That Mighty Casey, or the Royals winning the World Series this year, or any number of things can bring us joy. Now, they make us happy, but they don't bring us joy. We just get so confused about what joy really is. The problem is that joy is not a commodity. It can't be produced, it can't be bought, it can't be stolen. It can't be stolen. We can't get joy on discount at JCPenney's. We can't download joy. We can't lobby for it. We can't legislate it. We can't win it in a lawsuit. We can't turn it on with a remote control. Like all expressions of the grace of God, joy is a gift that we can only receive. Grace is free, freely given, because we can't enslave it. Grace is free because we can't be its master. Joy is an expression of God's grace. We can't tell it what to do. It can't be bought at any price. So when we look at the difference between happiness and joy, we find happiness in a lot of things we do in our lives. A good job can cause a sense of happiness. A loving relationship, money in the bank, a great vacation, good health. Those can all bring happiness. But joy is just unpredictable. Joy is unpredictable as the one who brings it. There is a difference between happiness and joy. Happiness we can try to achieve. Joy we can only receive. Advent is a journey to joy. And it is not us who are traveling. It is joy that is coming to us. You know, let's look back to our scripture today from Isaiah 40. We've told three or four stories here. Now let's hear a story from the Bible. The scripture today from chapter 40 of Isaiah is the book that is called the Book of Comfort, Consolation, Blessing, and Joy. It begins with the words, comfort ye, my people. The image that the prophet Isaiah uses to describe the journey of joy is the image of a highway. We can't manufacture joy. Says we can build a way for joy. We can make a way for joy to come to us. During the prophet Isaiah's time, it was the custom that if you wanted the king to come visit you, come see you in your community or your own village, that you had to go out and build a highway. You had to build a highway to make it easy for the king to get there. So, there's three things in this poem that mentions a that he says we can do to make a way for joy to come to us. The first thing that Isaiah says about the way that joy will come to us is that it will come in a highway from the desert. I think I understand this. I think I understand that joy comes to places where we have, like the desert, emptied our lives. And we moved all the clutter and all the stuff that fills our lives up. When we make an empty space or a desert, it empties room for joy to come into us. The second thing that Isaiah says about joy making its way to us, about making a way for joy to get to us, is that the joy is a revelation of the glory of God. Joy isn't really happiness or a sense of satisfaction about our own work, our own successes. It's not about our glory, but it's about opening a way so the glory of God can get to us, so that God's glory can reveal itself. Making a way for joy means giving up our attachment to our own successes, so that we can receive the glory of God coming to us. God is joy, true joy from top to bottom. So what we need to do is open up space in ourselves so that God's glory, God's joy, can get through to us. Joy really isn't about us. Joy is about God coming into us. What I don't understand so well is when Isaiah talks about the way being smooth and the mountains being leveled and the valleys being lifted up. In verse 4 it says, every valley shall be lifted up and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level and the rough places as a plain. So what does this mean? What does this mountain and valley business mean? You know, sitting and looking at the scripture this week, this is what I've come to. This is what I suspect Isaiah was trying to say. That in addition to giving up my attachment to the stuff in my life, and in addition to giving up my own glory, I may need to give up my attachment to even the obstacles in my life. I need to give my attachment to the mountains that I think I have to climb, the valleys that I think I need to survive, and the rough places in life that I have to pass through. You know, many of us are attached to these disadvantages. We may think we're not, but we are. We sometimes wallow in our distress. The stresses, the disappointments of our lives, that's all we can seem to talk about. We leave no room for joy. I believe that the third thing that Isaiah is trying to say is that to make way for joy to come to us is to let go of these things. Maybe we don't need to climb every mountain. Maybe we don't need to survive every valley or endure every rough place. Maybe we can let the mountains be leveled by our God, the valleys be filled by His presence, the rough places made smooth by His power and His strength. If joy is going to come to us this season, or any season, let's let go of the clutter. Let's let go of our own glory. Let's let go of all our distress and worries. And let's make a highway for the glory of God and the joy that only His presence in our life can bring. Will you bow your heads, please? Heavenly Father, we rejoice in your great wisdom and strength. And thank you for being the present help in our time of need. We ask that you send us out from this place. with a joyful expectation of what you are going to accomplish in each of our lives. And we ask that you would remain close to us, each one of us, in the days that lie ahead. Amen. Now, if we will, we will have our closing song. There's a song in the air. Salvation. Go in God's grace today. Amen.